Good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning, good morning. How's everybody doing today? This is the day that the Lord has made, and we should rejoice and be glad in it. What is going on, everybody? This beautiful, beautiful Wednesday. It is Wednesday, that's right. Wednesday, December the 17th of 2019. A beautiful, beautiful day. It's bright. It is sunny right here in Chesapeake, Virginia, within the US of A. So I just want to say good day to everyone. This is the virtual Bible study. And so we're going to get started momentarily. I know Facebook is doing what they do, sharing with people that I'm live at this particular moment. And so what we're going to do is, before I get into background information, I am going to start a watch party in a group. So I'm going to go ahead and prepare to set that up really quick. While we're here together and while we're live. And so again, thank you so much. If you want to grab some tea, if you want to grab some coffee, whatever it is you want to grab, so that we can definitely dig in just a few moments, that would be awesome. Hello, Miss Kim Pung, how you doing? Hello. Good morning, Donna. Good morning to you. I also see, of course, my sister coming in, Alicia Minto. And so we are about to get going. Let me go ahead and click on this little button here. And then there we go. Okay, so black. Here we go. Just trying to find the group, everybody. All right, here we go. Let's go. Type in join in for the Bible study. And then I'm gonna put mark 9. All right, here we go. And then of course, I'm gonna check the audio, making sure that the audio is good. In this particular group.
A few moments that would
All
be.
right, sounds pretty good. Sounds good. Let's greet those ladies in the group. Good morning, ladies. There we go. Awesome sauce. So, okay, yeah, good morning, everybody, once again. Good afternoon, depending on where you are in the world, because right now we're not just live on Facebook, but we're also live on Spreaker, iHeartRadio. We're live over at the leadershiptkostation.com website. And so I'm extremely excited, humbled at the same time as well, to be able to sow these nuggets, I'm saying these nuggets, these seeds into your lives based on the Word of God. And why we do what we do? Well, we believe that in order to win, because that's a part of our mission here with iLead, to help people win on the inside, that there's no better way to do that than to connect with God, connect with the Most High, and really understanding His will for our lives and how we can really just carry out his ultimate purpose and plan. And so that's why we're here. And we do this Monday through Saturdays around 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. So you're more than welcome. Come on in, all aboard. Okay. And so there are a couple of ways that you can be involved here with us. Number one, love this stream. Like if you love the Lord, I want to see those hearts just coming at me, right? Because that just lets God know as well that you're all for it. Like, sold out, ready to just rock it out for him, right? Representing the kingdom. So go ahead and hit those hearts up, share those hearts. Also, number two, another way to get involved is the comment section. Comments, right? How can we can connect, we can interact with one another. If there's something that resonates with you, if there's a question that you have, all of the above there. Go ahead and share that in the comment section. And then number three, my goodness, the power to be able to evangelize and share the good news, the kingdom of God with others by hitting that share button. That's what we can do. And it's free. It's free. Like you didn't have to come out your pocket. You didn't have to do anything. You can hit the share button and we can help activate the faith of others who are connected to us. And you never know, someone may need an extra dose of the Word of God. And I believe that this can help them. So go ahead and hit that share button, share in the group, a fan page, a direct message, right? Your timeline, wherever you want to share it. Good morning, Pamela. I see you as well. Thank you so much for joining me here. And so that's what we do. Now, if you need an overview of what to expect while we're here on the platform, let me share with you a little bit of information about that. So we do come on to the platform here and we go over guidelines. We about to pray. That's what we're about to do next. We're about to pray just to make sure our hearts and our minds are ready to receive the word. We're going to read scripture. We're going to break it down and see what, for example, what encouraged Mark to include these verses. We're going to also see how to make the word practical. How can we apply this to our lives today as leaders, as entrepreneurs? And then we're going to summarize what we've read. And then, lastly, we're going to pray so that we can be dismissed. So that is what we do. And hopefully you're good and you're ready to go, because I'm ready to go too. So let's go ahead and pray. So Father God in heaven, Lord, we say thank you so much for this brand new day. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercies. We thank you for you just being a loving God. We thank you for you being the true and the living God, because you live. And so, Father, we understand and we know that it's through you that we live, we move, and we have our being. And we thank you for your mercies that have been abundant and brand new on today. And so even as we are before your throne of grace, Father, we're just simply asking that you would forgive us of all sin. If there has been anything we have said, thought, done that has not glorified you, we ask for your forgiveness, dear Lord. And we're just praying and even asking as we're here that you would give us greater understanding, knowledge, wisdom as we're reading and about to partake in your word. Help us to rightly divide the word of truth and to be able to apply it to our lives and be able to share it boldly with others. Father, may your will be done. May you help us to receive the meat in this word this morning. And we just pray that you'll be glorified through it all. And so we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. So once again, it is on. Let's go ahead and dive into this. Again, Mark chapter 9. Verses 1 through 29 is what we're going to be reading and expounding upon. Again, if you get insight, go ahead and share your insight, thoughts that God may have shared with you. Share it in the comment section. Okay? Awesome. Okay, so we're going to start at, again, verse number 1, and we're going to read to verse 29. And it reads as follows. And he, Jesus, right, said to them, "Assuredly, I say to you that there are some standing here who will not taste death till they see the kingdom of God present with power." See, now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John and led them up on a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. His clothes became shining, exceedingly white, like snow, such as no launderer on earth can whiten them. And Elijah appeared to them with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. And let us make 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Because he did not know what to say, for they were greatly afraid. And a cloud came and overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved son. Hear him." Suddenly, when they had looked around, they saw no one anymore, but only Jesus with themselves. Now, as they came down from the mountain, he commanded them that they should tell no one the things they had seen till the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept this word to themselves, questioning what the rising from the dead meant. And they asked him, saying, "Why do the scribes say that Elijah must come first?" Then he answered and told them, "Indeed, Elijah is coming first and restores all things. And how is it written concerning the Son of Man that he must suffer many things and be treated with contempt? But I say to you that Elijah has also come, and they did to him whatever they wished, as it is written of him." And when he came to the disciples, he saw a great multitude around them, and scribes disputing with them. Immediately, when they saw him, all the people were greatly amazed, and running to him, greeted him. And he asked the scribes, "What are you discussing with them?" Then one of the crowd answered and said, "Teacher, I brought you my son, who has a mute spirit. And wherever it seizes him, it throws him down. He foams at the mouth gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples that they should cast it out, but they could not. He answered him and said, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me. Then they brought him to him. And when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed, foaming at the mouth. So he asked his father, how long has this been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Immediately, the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more. Then the spirit cried out and convulsed him greatly and came out of him. And he became as one dead, so that many said, he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he had come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, why could we not cast it out? And he said to them, this kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. Amen, amen, and amen. So we just finished reading Mark chapter 9, verses 1 through 29. So we're just going to take a closer look at that which we have read. I'm going to break it down just a bit. There's a lot that we can break down and receive from this, okay? And again, if God gives you insight, share it below. But we started at verse number 1, okay? Of course, what he's saying simply here is that some will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God present with power, okay? With power. See, the event had Jesus had in mind has been variously interpreted really as his resurrection, his ascension, the coming of the Spirit at Pentecost, the spread of Christianity, okay? Now, some interpret that particular verse a little bit different, right? A little bit different, okay? But all of the gospel accounts, right? All of the gospel accounts place this promise immediately really before the transfiguration. So I just wanted to throw that in there before I went to it a little bit deeper. But if you look at verse number 2, it says, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, right? Led them up to the mountain apart by themselves, you know, and he was transfigured before them. Okay, he was transfigured before him. Now, notice, you know, these men are a part of Jesus's inner circle, right? Okay, these three were sometimes allowed to really witness events that the other disciples were not able to see. Okay. So they went onto this high mountain, transfiguration had taken place. Now, when we say transfigured, we're just talking about being changed in form, okay? Being changed in form. But notice what it continues to say. It says his clothes became shining, exceedingly white like snow, such as no launderer on the earth can whiten them. So when you look at this, you have to imagine that the divine glory, you know, that was really emanating from Jesus made it even to the case where his clothes was like this brilliant white light. Okay, his clothes. And we know that light is often associated with God's visible presence. Okay, so that's something to take note of. And then look at verse 4. It says, and Elijah appeared to them, right, with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. Okay, talking with Jesus. See, there's some symbolism here. There's some symbolism here. Why these particular men appeared with Jesus, okay? It's really symbolic of the prophets, right? Elijah. And the law, Moses, okay? The two great divisions of the Old Testament. Okay, so I just want you to understand that. And this is what makes it unique. So they were talking with Jesus, and they were talking with Jesus, really focusing in on the subject of his coming death. Okay, of his coming death. Look at verse 5. It says, then Peter answered and said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. And let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Okay, one for Elijah. Now, Rabbi, we often hear Jesus, just approached and actually called this Rabbi, meaning master. Okay, master. It's like, you know, a sign of respect and honor given to Jews. Okay, or given to, I should say, respected teachers by the Jews. So, it is possible that Peter's suggestion here about the tabernacles, you know, really reflected his belief. Some say it really reflected his belief that the millennial kingdom was about to begin. Okay, so that's what some people actually say. But if you continue on, he says, because he did not know what to say in verse 6, for they were greatly afraid. And in verse 7, it says, and a cloud came and overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, look, this is my beloved son. Hear him. Okay, hear him. So this is the glory cloud. This is the Shekinah cloud, right? And it's often pictured throughout the Old Testament, again, symbolizing God's presence, right? So a voice came out of the cloud. This was the Father's voice. The Father's voice. Now, we hear this often as well, where it says, this is my beloved son, where the Father confirms this. He repeats this affirmation of his love for the son, okay? Even the first time that this was done was during, you know, Jesus's baptism, okay? But it says, hear him. The Father says, hear him. So him meaning Jesus, the one to whom the law and the prophets pointed to, okay? So the law and the prophets point to Jesus and his coming, okay? So that's what he was trying to bring attention to. Look at verse number 8. So suddenly when they had looked around, no one was there anymore. The only one that was there was Jesus. And then in verse 9, now as they came down from the mountain, he commanded them that, look, don't tell anybody. Don't tell anyone what you had just seen until, of course, it says the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Okay, it had risen from the dead. And then in verse 10, they kept this word to themselves, questioning what the rising from the dead meant. So they really didn't understand. They did not know. You see, the disciples believed in a future resurrection. They did. But what really confused them, okay, what really confused them was Jesus's implication that his own resurrection was imminent, right? And thus, you know, so was his death at the same time. So their confusion just provides even more evidence that they really did not understand Jesus's mission, his entire mission. Look at verse 11. And it says, and they asked him, saying, why do the scribes say that Elijah must come first? Okay, the scribes. See, the scribes' teaching in this case was not really based on tradition, but it was based upon the Old Testament. Okay, based upon the Old Testament. The scribes and the Pharisees, you know, they also, no doubt, they really argued that Jesus could not be the Messiah, you know, based on the fact that Elijah had not yet appeared. Okay, so confused at this, the disciples asked Jesus for his interpretation of it. Okay, look at verse 12. It says, then he answered and told them, indeed, Elijah is coming first and restores all things, right? And how is it written concerning the Son of Man that he must suffer many things and be treated with contempt? You see, Jesus affirmed, right, the correctness of their interpretation, okay, which must have puzzled or really confused the disciples even more. But Jesus pointed out that the prophecies about Elijah, you know, in no way precluded the suffering and death of the Messiah. Okay. Look at verse 13. It says, but I say to you that Elijah has also come, and they did to him whatever they wished, as it is written of him. So Jesus directly then addressed the disciples' question. The prophecies of Elijah's coming had been fulfilled in John the Baptist. Again, let me repeat this one more time. The prophecies of Elijah's coming have been fulfilled in John the Baptist. Okay. John, remember, he came in the spirit and power of Elijah. Remember that? Okay. And would have fulfilled prophecies if they had believed. If they had believed. But, okay, because they did reject both John the Baptist and Jesus, there will be another who will come in the spirit and power of Elijah before the second coming of Christ. There will be another. Now understand, the Jewish leaders rejected John the Baptist. And Herod, right, the king at the time, Herod, killed him. Okay, killed him. So that's something, of course, that we have to take note of. But then there's a shift, okay, because when he came to the disciples in verse 14, he saw the multitude around them and the scribes, they were actually disputing certain things. And so when he saw this, he saw him, all the people were greatly amazed in verse 15, running to Jesus, and they begin to greet him. And so Jesus then proceeds and asks the scribes, what are y'all talking about? What are you all discussing? And then a person from the crowd answered and said, teacher, I brought to you my son who has a mute spirit. So there was a boy who had a demonically induced ability to speak. Okay, a detail that's really only found in this gospel account. So he could not speak very much. Okay. And so he says, look, wherever it seizes him, it throws him down, foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. It says, so I spoke to your disciples that they should cast it out, but they could not. Okay, they could not. You see, the disciples' failure is surprising, you know, in light of the fact that, you know, the power had been granted to them by Jesus, they still could not cast out this spirit. Okay. Look at verse 19, though. It says, he answered them and said, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me. Generation. When I hear that word, it really indicates that Jesus, you know, he's really tired at this particular point. He's wanting them to understand, you know, that he's given them the power to do this, but they have to take a closer look at how all of this is done. Okay, how all of this is done. But he's also addressing the scribes, the unbelieving scribes, who were, you know, they were actually gloating over the disciples' failure and with unbelieving Israel in general. So they were gloating there. But look at what happens, though, in this situation. Look at what happens. Verse 20, they brought him to him, and when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him. He fell on the ground, wallowed, foaming at the mouth. And so, Jesus asked the father, look, how long has this been going on? He says, from childhood. So this child, this kid must have been, what, preteen or probably heading towards teenage years, because it says from childhood. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, he says, right, have compassion on us and help us. So this demon, okay, was violent and a dangerous one. Okay, open fires and unfenced bodies of waters. It was actually common during that time. And so the father's statement added to the seriousness of the situation. The seriousness. Okay, so it's creating a lot of hardship for this family, I can imagine. Right? And so look how Jesus responds. He says in verse 23, he says, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. All things are possible. So I want you to understand something. The issue was not his lack of power, right? But the father's lack of faith. You see, Jesus often healed apart from faith in some situations. But here, Jesus chose to emphasize the power of faith. Okay, he's emphasizing the power of faith. And so Jesus healed multitudes, but many, you know, in most cases, he did not, you know, did not believe in him. So let me just put it this way. He healed multitudes, but many, if not most of them, did not actually believe in him. They did not believe in him, but of course, he still healed in the midst and did what needed to be done. Okay. But look at verse 24. It says, immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Help. This is like one of the most powerful prayers and requests in the Word of God. Let me repeat that one more time. Okay? He says, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. You see, he admitted the imperfection of his faith. He admitted it. Okay? But it was mixed with doubt. Okay? He says, help my unbelief. You see, the desperate father pleaded with Jesus to help him to have the greater faith the Lord demanded of him. He wanted greater faith. Okay? So he humbled himself in that regard and said, look, help my unbelief. Help my unbelief. Okay? And so in verse 25, Jesus saw that the people came running to him. He rebuked the unclean spirit and said to him, deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more. Right? See, Jesus acted without further delay, okay? Perhaps just probably spared the boy and his anguished father from any more embarrassment, okay? The Lord did not perform miracles to satisfy thrill seekers. So he's not trying to satisfy a crowd. It wasn't about that. Again, it's about the message, okay? And understand, Jesus's absolute authority over demons is definitely documented throughout the New Testament, and we do see it here. Okay, we do see it here. And it really just demonstrates his deity by power over the natural world as well. See, his authority over demons demonstrated his deity by power over the supernatural world. Okay, so his healings demonstrated his power over the natural world. But his authority over demons demonstrated his power, his deity, by power over the supernatural world itself. All right, so we see this here. So he tells the spirit and commands the spirit to come out of him. And so guess what happened in verse 26? The spirit cried out, convulsed him greatly, tried to put up a struggle, and came out of him. And he became as one dead, so that many said he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and then he arose. Okay, but here's the most powerful part of this. Look at verse 29. He says, this kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. You see, here's one point I want to make. Some demons are more powerful and obstinate, you know, and thus more really resistant, I should say, to being casted out than others. Okay. And so perhaps overconfident from their earlier success because they went out. Remember, Jesus sent them out. So perhaps they were overconfident from the success earlier. The disciples became really enamored, perhaps with their own gifts, and they neglected to draw from the divine power, okay? Prayer and fasting. Notice that combination. It gives you to a point where you're totally reliant upon the Father, right? And the power that lies within, which is the power of God. And you do need to understand that prayer and fasting is one of some of the essential disciplines that we must engage in as leaders, as believing, spirit-led leaders. We need to be prayed up. Things are changing, especially from the time in which this particular account was written. And so we need to continue to stay before God's throne of grace, you know, stay before him with prayer. Fasting meaning, of course, just separating some time aside from our normal day-to-day routine. And just really giving and devoting that time to connecting with the Most High and reading his word, studying the scripture, because it refuels us. And he, of course, empowers us even more when we do it. Now, there's no set specific amount of time that you need to fast. You just have to be mindful of what you do and make sure, of course, that you are led by God when you set aside that time to fast. Some people fast and separate themselves from technology. They set aside themselves from food, you know, certain foods, or, you know, just really have to be cautious and really have to be in tune with God to let him lead you and guide you in that regard. But as you can see here, prayer and fasting is what Jesus notates, okay, and that he specifies needed to happen in order to see this demon be casted out. Okay. And so again, for us as leaders, what is this saying to us as leaders and entrepreneurs? Well, we do need to be prayed up. Okay. You know, there are certain things that it's going to require power, extra power. Okay. And we never know what we're going to run into. We never know what we're going to encounter along this journey. And so we, as disciples, followers of Christ, we have to be prayed up. Okay. And there may be times where you do have to separate yourself and engage in fasting. And so you have to be sensitive to discerning when God wants you to do that and how long of a time, you know, he wants you to be able to do that. I know specifically for myself, yeah, there are times you just have to be obedient because you never know. God can be giving you a heads up about certain things. It could be certain situations in life that you're about to encounter that he needs to prepare you for. And so if you're not sensitive to that and you go into it and you're not ready, you're not spiritually fueled up, you never know what you're going to face. Okay. There have been times where I've walked into situations and you can tell, like God gave me discernment to say that there is something within a specific individual. And you can hear it almost. There have been one or two occasions where I actually heard distortion of a voice in a person. And at that particular moment, I already knew, you know, and God already gave me that spirit to discern that something else is speaking. Okay, you really need to be prayed up because dealing with any demonic force is nothing to play around with. Because here's the thing, and just like we read and heard about in scripture, they know when you're not prepared, and they know when you don't belong to the Most High, okay? They know, and they're smart too. See, the one thing that we have to understand with the spiritual realm is that the enemy knows scripture too. They're not totally ignorant of these things, and so this is why it's important that you stay prayed up. You're connecting with God on a day-by-day basis. You're engaging in prayer. All of these essential disciplines here are very, very important in our walk with Christ. It really, really is. Remember, we are his mouthpiece. We are his body in the earth. And so prayer just helps us to clearly hear from him. And notice I said hear. We have to also be mindful that with prayer, it is communication, us with God, right? And so that means that he speaks to us even more so than we're giving our requests or, you know, we're speaking to him. So we have to have that ear to hear, that spiritual ear to hear. Okay. So again, I just want to say thank you so very much, everybody, for tuning in, plugging into the virtual Bible study on today. It's been an honor. Again, if you have insight, thoughts that you want to share, definitely share them below. But this stuff is real. You have to pray, be prayed up, have your full armor of God on. I love talking and teaching on the armor of God. That's one of the most, I just get the most fulfilled speaking about that because we as believers, we definitely need to have our armor on. The moment we wake up and we open up our eyes, guess what? It's time. You know, you enter the battlefield the moment you open your eyes. I say that because the battle begins first in the mind. Okay? The battle begins first in the mind. So that's why I said the moment you open your eyes, it's on. It's on. So you really have to be prepared, connect with God. That's why I believe that when you first wake up and you gather yourself together, of course, connect with God immediately. Connect with God immediately because you just never know. You never know. All right, guys, let's go ahead and pray so that we can be dismissed. So, Father God in heaven, Lord, we say thank you so much for this time that you've given us. We thank you so much for your grace, and we thank you so much for your mercies. We thank you for your loving kindness, your peace that passeth all understanding. We're just asking that it continues to guard our hearts and our minds throughout the course of this day. We thank you. We just pray that, God, you would give us discernment to knowing when you'd like for us to break apart and to spend even more time with you in prayer, times where you need for us to fast and separate ourselves for a time. Help us to understand when you desire of us to do that. And help us to be prepared for those moments where your power needs to be heavily relied upon. And so, God, we thank you for this time of teaching. We ask, Father, that you'll bring this word back to our remembrance as we need to recall it. And so, God, if there be individuals listening in right now, live or to the replay, and maybe they don't have a relationship with you, but they desire to have one, you say in your word that if we believe with our hearts and confess with our mouths the Lord Jesus, that we too shall be saved. And so, touch the minds and hearts of those who are asking you to come into their hearts and to find and to make, to dwell with them and to make a home within them. And so, God, we thank you for this time. And we're just asking, Lord, as we go forward today, that you'll be with us, that you'll protect us as we travel to and fro, that you'll be with our children, for those who are parents, that you would watch over them as well and protecting them from dangers seen and unseen. And so, God, strengthen our bodies. If there be those listening in with any aches or pains or any joint issues, any issues with diabetes and sugar, I just pray, Father God, that you would touch them, that you would help them to eat the right foods and exercise as they should. Father, strengthen them, every bone, every muscle, every organ. God, we thank you so much for being a healer and knowing that it is with the stripes of Christ that we were healed. And so it's already done. We thank you so much for healing, for deliverance, for restoration of our bodies. And we just ask that your will be done. In the mighty name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen. All right, you all have a blessed, blessed day. It's been an honor. Remember, definitely trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge him so that he can direct your path. Remember, I love you, but God loves you all the more. Be blessed.